When people asked how he got a start in advertising, Vikas joked that it had found him on the street. There was more truth to this than he let on. It was over a decade ago. Akshay Sethi watched as a clumsy teenager struggled with a hot plate of anda bhurji. Clearly, he needed to put it down before he could eat. Every surface around the roadside stall was occupied. Akshay waved at the teenager, inviting him over. Sheepishly, the kid made his way to the car and put his plate on the bonnet, propped open by an empty Coke bottle. This was the first time they met. Within the 15 minutes it had taken them to finish their meals, Vikas had an interview at Akshay's advertising agency the next day. The management course at Mumbai University barely kept Vikas occupied. He spent the next few years rushing to work immediately after his morning classes. The small stipend he received was more than enough to cover his needs. Over time, the arrangement evolved into full-time employment and his break into the city's advertising industry. Akshay called Vikas when he heard about his decision to leave the agency he had started. There was a lot to talk about, and the conversation inevitably meant drinks at Teddy's. The bar was their customary meeting place. Akshay was waiting when Vikas arrived. "Vikas, how have you been?" Akshay said. He stood up to give Vikas a hug. "Good as it gets. I don't think I've ever seen this place so empty," he replied. "It's not even 7 yet, but forget that. Tell me what's happening. Big moves in life?" "Are yeah, not like you didn't see it coming." A pitcher of beer got the evening going. Akshay told Vikas about the trip he made to Norway with his wife. "Public bolte rehta hai, but man, when you are actually there looking up at the northern lights, it's something else. Fully worth the hype. You have to see it sometime." "It's on the list, man. Problem is, the list doesn't end." Once the first pitcher was out of the way, they both opted for something stronger. Pleasantries were concluded and the conversation could move to more pressing matters. "So then tell me, what finally happened between you two?" "Man, it was just not working. It's all done now, so onwards and upwards." "You know, I was going to call you when I saw your Treasure Island campaign. Full power. Did you submit it anywhere in the award circuit?" "No, man, can't afford those submissions at all." "Arey, I would have submitted it. Anyway, now you aren't even at that agency, so no point. Ab bata, what's next?" "Chilling mostly. I have 6-month non-compete, so nothing in the media space for a bit. We'll see what else is around, but for now, just take a bit of a break." "What non-compete? I was speaking to someone about you recently, recommended they talk to you. The guy's a little different, but you should definitely meet him." "Didn't know about this non-compete." "Thanks a lot, man, but I think I'll just take a bit of a time off for now. Got a bit of money to keep me afloat." "Up to you. But listen, if you talk to these people, they should be able to work around your non-compete." "Nah, think I'll just do nothing for a bit. Live the dream while I can." "I don't know why you keep saying you'll go mad if you have nothing to do for a month. You should try it. It's great." "That lazy streak of yours will never go. If you kids had it your way, you would just sit around and do nothing. Then you would want someone to pay you a ton of money for that." "You kids? Now I'm representative of an entire generation? I don't feel like I fit in with any of those kids, man. I'm nearly 30. I think 4 or 5 years younger is an entire generation gap. 10, even 15 years older seems okay, but I can't handle 4 years younger. Old age is happening," Vikas said. The music in the bar got louder. "Just be careful you don't go into retirement. Break and all is fine, but don't wait too long before getting back to something. It becomes difficult if you take too long off. With you though, you might never be able to find anything." "This is too boring. That doesn't pay. There's no challenge with this lada lasun. Main khud gaan marega if you become one of those lazy wankers who think they are too intelligent to do anything. Do something. Whatever the fuck it is, do something." "But I am too intelligent to do anything. I'm not going to do menial shit. Arey, but new things reminds me. What is this I hear about you hobnobbing with politicians?" "Where are you hearing this?" "Actually, never mind. But shit, those campaigns. Tera seer nahi hai, wo alag baat hai. But you have to give them the sheer number of minds they sway. Whatever the agenda, their words get heard." "Fuck, are you contesting some elections or something? Be the change you want to see and all." "What? You won't vote for me?" Akshay laughed. "I don't vote at all. But no chance I'm voting for you. Think of it as a favor. I don't think you'd make a very good politician. Don't think you're slimy enough to pull it off." "How come you don't vote?" "Arey, what's the point? The whole system is fucked. Whoever you vote for is a chooth and they all just fuck you over. This democracy business doesn't work. Don't tell me it's because people like me don't vote that we have these douchebags. It's all just fucked." "I won't use a cliche like that, but seriously, democracy is not broken. What you see is actually democracy working efficiently. What looks efficient to you, man? Think about it, nah. If the country looked like your idea of perfect, that's when democracy is broken. Our leaders are an accurate representation of us. Not you and me, us. The average Indian. The uneducated guy in the village who has grown up idolizing his thug uncle with an endless supply of booze and women. Matlab, the guy learned to talk to women from Salman Khan movies. That's where the average is. So when a politician pulls off a scam or says something shitty, it's because that's the world they come from. That's who he is deep down. Why should that guy live by your normal compass? Isn't that worse? Better, worse, all is subjective. Now don't get upset, just listen. When the country criminalizes homosexuality, you get offended. Theek hai. But the fact is that a massive chunk of the population believes it's an abomination. You are the minority. Why are you expecting things to go your way? That's your pitch to make me vote? I don't care if you vote or not. Just be aware of what is what. The reason you are unhappy is because you are such a minority. If you weren't disillusioned and thought everything is good, that is a problem. What makes you happy seriously pisses off a much larger number of people whose beliefs and convictions are much stronger than yours. But their beliefs are just wrong. You are not really debating that with me, are you? That's the thing. Any belief system is exactly that. It is not a fact. It's not about wrong or right. It's about how much conviction. When you say their belief is wrong, you're trying to impose your belief on others. How is that different from any of these religious guys? You obviously think you are right, but so does the other guy. There can never be a universal right or wrong. It comes down to who is louder in the shouting match. The reason you are upset is because they have a louder voice than you. You say don't harm snakes for religion. They say they have to do their puja. Both of you get upset if you lose. Now, why are your sentiments more important than theirs? No, there is a clear line there. As long as other people or animals are not affected, I have no problem with people praying or whatever at home. You can't tell someone to discard bits and pieces of their faith because it offends someone. What if I told you science had led to nuclear bombs? We should just ban science? I know it sounds like absolute rubbish to you, but what you say sounds like absolute rubbish to them. It's just your opinion versus theirs, and the fact is that there will always be more of them. If your will was imposed on a billion people, you think the country won't have issues? You can't blame democracy. It's doing its job. What you are actually upset about is that in this country, democracy is not working in your favor. Of course, democracy might need an upgrade, but humans don't really have a system that can replace it. Not yet, at least. I mean, look at it this way. When you are upset, you go to a bar and rant. If all the devout Hindus in the country were upset, you would have a serious law and order situation. What would you prefer? Vikas knew he didn't have the answer to the question. With his stirrer, he created a little whirlpool in his drink. The ice in the glass made an odd pattern in the current. Akshay's words did the same with the thoughts in his head. Ideas that didn't match his own. He knew he didn't agree with them, but in that moment, he could not articulate a defense. The bar was now full. People had trickled into the spaces between tables, holding their drinks close. Conversations filled the room, punctuated by the odd shriek and crackle. Akshay and Vikas were both smiling as their conversation meandered through lighter topics. Once that did not involve changing the lens through which they saw the world. So this guy went in there with the presentation, ready, properly rehearsed and all, Akshay said. He was trying hard to hold his laughter back long enough to finish the story. Obviously, he was nervous pitching to a big VC firm. God knows how long he must have spent preparing, but sometimes even a laptop needs a break. Our man connected his laptop to the projector and started. Beech mein, he needed to show a reference for something he wanted to deploy, so he went to his browser. Type karte karte, uska computer freeze ho gaya. You know, when you search for something, there's a drop-down of prompts? This guy was halfway through typing analog. Fuck, on the projector, the drop-down was showing anal sex, anal probing, anal suppositories. The thing was hung, so he couldn't do shit. He had to pull the projector cable straight out of the socket. They both burst into laughter. Akshay paid their bill. It was tradition. Pink Floyd's Coming Back to Life played over the speakers. It signaled it was closing time. Vikas decided to wait with Akshay until his Uber arrived. Mr. Kelang still asks about you, Akshay said, lighting a cigarette. He's still a client? His son deals with us now. He has taken over the marketing side of things. Is he more sorted now? Back in the day, he was a little dense, nah? He's a bit off, but not as much drama. Akanksha handles their account. I think he's in love with her, but she doesn't take any shit from him. I don't have to step in. Have you met Akanksha? No, I don't think I have. Drop by office sometime. Vikas sipped on the bottle of beer he'd picked up for his ride home. His auto scurried through the narrow by-lanes of Bandra. He grunted. A row of stationary red tail lights came into view. Traffic. His concern wasn't the delay, just the dent it put in his buzz. Naka bandi hai, the auto driver said. Autos were rarely stopped at checkpoints. Vikas wasn't worried. He took a swig from the bottle. Before the rickshaw reached the barricade, he hid it behind his back. He was less subtle than he thought he had been. His auto was asked to step on one side of the street. Vikas hoped the policeman wanted to check the driver's papers, but he had no such luck. The policeman asked Vikas to step out. He did, leaving the bottle on the back seat. Wo kya hai? The policeman asked, pointing at the bottle. Beer hai, sir. Bar band ho gaya tha, to parcel mein lena pada. Aisa allowed nahi hai, daru peena riksha mein. Sir, khula bottle tha, magar ghar jaake peene wala tha main. To aaj kitna drink hua aapka? Sir, bar mein 3-4 aur ye wala last. Vikas's Hindi was getting shaky. Achha, iska fine lagega. Kal court mein aake bharna padega aapko. Are sorry sir, galti ho gaya hai. Jaane do na. Galti kya hai? Isi ke liye procedure hai. The policeman pulled out a little pad. Are sir, ek minute. अब सुनो तो सही, अभी आप फाइन लोगे, वो पैसा किधर जाएगा? फाइन सारा गवर्नमेंट के पास जाता है, फिर वो देखते हैं उसका क्या होता है. सर देखो ना, गलती हो गई है और मैं फाइन भरने वाला हूँ, मगर ये सरकार को नहीं देना, सब चोर है. आप अमाउंट बताओ, मैं आपको दे दूँगा, मगर आप पर्ची मत काटो. आप पूरी रात इधर खड़े हो, मेहनत कर रहे हो, बेवड़े लोग को गाड़ी नहीं चलाने देते हो. आप रखो, मेरे को कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है. आप हमारे सेफ्टी का ध्यान रखते हो, आप रखो. द पुलिस मैन लुक्ड अप एट हिम. विकास रीच फॉर हिज वॉलेट एंड पुल्ड आउट 300 रुपीज. टोटल 500 है, 200 रिक्शे का लगेगा घर जाने के लिए, बाकी आप रखो सर प्लीज. द पुलिस मैन स्माइल्ड एंड पॉकेटेड द मनी. विकास रिटर्न टू द ऑटो एंड कंटिन्यू टू सिप ऑन हिज बियर. व्हेन ही गॉट आउट ऑफ द रिक्शा ही डिडंट नोटिस द मैन होल. Earlier that day, the open hole had been guarded by a makeshift fence made of twigs. The metal cover had now been replaced. Someone in the municipal corporation had done their job. It was rare for them to get credit when they got things right. This was not one of those times. Who the hell do you think you are? A distant voice drifted through the open window. Vikas sat on his bed. It was past noon. The commotion outside was stark in the murmur of a calm afternoon. He didn't pay it much attention. Instead, he went back to reading an old article from the Rolling Stone archives. It was an interview with Julian Assange from when he was hiding in the English countryside. The shouting outside escalated. Another voice, equally animated, had come to the fore. It wasn't as clear as the first. Both men were yelling at each other. It didn't merit much attention. While reading, Vikas wondered if anybody in recent history had polarized opinion like this man. Most of the time, mainstream media picked a side and stuck to it. This man, however, had been glorified and vilified in almost equal proportion. Multiple biopics all portraying him in very different light. He read on. An undeniably great mind attached to a fragile ego. The fragile ego had obviously been the focus of a lot of media attention. Especially after the adjectives used to describe him shifted from revolutionary and whistleblower to rapist and megalomaniac. The limitless resources of the government of the United States of America may or may not have had something to do with that. He must get lonely, Vikas thought. The shouting outside got louder. Vikas got out of bed and walked to his window. The argument was over two cars grating each other's side. Both cars showed signs of damage, but not serious enough to warrant concern over injury. The men faced off. A small crowd surrounded them. The yelling match was now a scuffle. Both of them grabbed the other's collar. They wrestled awkwardly. No one really gained the upper hand. This was the peak of the altercation. Neither of them would commit to a punch. The fight fizzled out. They are both probably Bombay born and bred. A Delhi guy would have thrown a punch, Vikas thought. He would have been offended had anyone accused him of stereotyping the men. It's just a light-hearted generalization. Most stereotypes are actually based in truth, he would argue. He didn't stop to wonder what stereotypes, given enough fuel, could grow into. Can't believe you're dragging me to this shit, Vikas said. He noticed Garima's well-fitted dress, open from the back but for an intricate mesh of red cloth. He'd never seen her wear it before. She looked good. He didn't tell her. Okay, for tonight, don't be a chew to anyone here, she said. Who is this guy you're into anyway? I'm not into anyone. This guy is a friend who I met through work. He is having a party and I didn't want to go alone, okay? I've dealt with enough of your shit with girls you're hitting on, so just keep quiet and behave yourself. Sure, but that means you're hitting on him, right? Happy to return the favor. She responded with a sigh. Aren't your friends from work here? Why will you be alone? How many questions? Bust now. Just have a good time. That's the point of a party. Tell me if you want me to introduce you to anyone in particular, okay? The elevator doors opened and the two of them walked towards the music. So glad you could make it, the host said. He held the door to the flat open for them. He wiped his hand on the checkered green shirt he wore before he held it out. Vikas hoped the dampness was only condensation from his glass. Hi, I'm Arif, he said politely. He turned to Garima and gave her a hug. This is Vikas, she said. They walked into the house. At one end of the large living room was a set of sofas. They formed a sitting area that included a ledge extending inwards from the window. A dining table stood at the opposite end. On it were bottles of alcohol, a few glasses, cartons of juice, and a bowl of chips. They were the healthy kind. Sweet potato, baked, not fried. About 30 people were scattered across the room in little clusters. Some of them were already dancing. Clearly, the party had been up and running for a while. For Vikas, it was a welcome change of scene. He enjoyed his friend's company, but their conversation was getting stale. He was in a rut. A lot of the plans he had made with them were to avoid the low point of drinking alone. A new set of people offered all sorts of possibilities. Maybe he could make new friends, an idea that became more appealing with age. On the other hand, he could get trapped making small talk with people who travelled to plush resorts for holidays, in groups of 12. All the Instagram feeds flooded with the same pictures. Hashtag Wanderlust, the horror. Nice place you got here, Vikas said to Arif. He opened one of the bottles of wine he brought with him. Garima looked at the bucket of punch that stood on the kitchen counter and decided to share the wine. Thanks. It's mostly my mother. She's particular about these things, Arif said. He poured himself a generous helping of single malt with a few cubes of ice. Soon, he led Garima across the room and introduced her to his friends. Vikas followed the two of them. He gulped his wine in between unnecessarily polite hellos. He wasn't sure which song was playing off the expensive sound system, but it was definitely the XX. Most of the time, music was a reliable measure of space, a vibe or a group of people. Vikas had always trusted his instincts with it. The XX is fine, he thought. It could be much worse. The ledge beside the window made a comfortable seat. Garima and Arif had settled on the sofa next to him. They were all part of a larger conversation. More introductions followed. A chubby guy with a ponytail and a thin moustache shared the other sofa with a girl wearing broad-rimmed spectacles. Sitting directly opposite Vikas was a much younger-looking boy. He wore a collar t-shirt and, more noticeably, shiny white sneakers. Vikas paid attention to their names, but none of them stuck in his memory. In the middle of a discussion that revolved around exposed brick walls in restaurants, the boy opposite Vikas pulled out a small plastic bag. He looked around and grabbed what looked like a flooring tile. He placed the tile on his lap and poured out the contents of the bag. The white powder settled into a small mound and he began to cut lines. He handled his credit card with skill. It seemed like a well-rehearsed combination of function and style. Cut you a couple? He asked Vikas without looking away from his handiwork. No thanks. Garima seemed comfortable enough with Arif at her side. It was time to sever the tether. Vikas didn't know anyone else in the room. That, however, was no reason to cling to Garima, who clearly didn't need his company. I'm getting myself another drink, he said. He decided to explore another part of the room before he got a refill. Are you sitting in the corner alone just because you don't want to share? Vikas looked up to see two faces grinning down at him. He licked the joint and smiled. You guys waited for me to finish just so that you don't have to do any of the work, right? I'm Vikas, he said. Anu, one of them said. She held out a lighter. Disha, the other one said. You must be doing something right. Two girls are coming up and talking to you at a party. I do have some exceptional rolling skills. But you're right. This has never happened before. Normally, I have to offer to buy a girl a drink and hope she doesn't walk away, Vikas said. He lit the joint and the three of them passed it around. Next time we meet, I'll buy you a drink, Anu said. Now that is a rarity. I might hold you to that one, Vikas said. What do you mean rarity? Nobody buys you drinks? Disha asked. Well, I'm a guy. I don't mean to sound sexist, but nobody buys me drinks. Maybe a few friends of mine if I'm broke, but you know what I mean, he said. Oh wow, I promise whenever we meet next, I'll buy you one as well, Disha said. Please do. It would make my day. Like a carousal, faces came and went. Anu and Disha knew everyone there. They took it upon themselves to help Vikas navigate the room. They introduced him to people, included him in their conversations, and made sure at least one of them stayed by his side at all times. He was grateful. Disha! Garima exclaimed. She jumped off the sofa. The two of them gave each other a hug. Do you know my friends Anu and Vikas? Disha asked. Hi Anu, Garima said. Your friend Vikas? No, I don't think I know your friend Vikas, she said, handing him the bottle of wine she was holding. He took it and poured into his glass. Wine etiquette seemed to be of little consequence now. He kept pouring until the glass was full. For all that complaining, you seem like you are having fun, Garima said once she found a moment with Vikas. So sexy you look, swigging from the bottle, he said. Learn from you only, but seriously, very cool. I thought I'd have to introduce you to some girls here, but you seem to be doing pretty well. Fuck off, asshole. What did you just say? The voice came at them from another direction. I was talking to this asshole here, Vikas said. He looked around. Don't talk to women like that, the big guy with the thin mustache said. I've known her for years, man. It's okay. It's not okay, man. This is not an excuse, man. That's not the way to talk to women, man. I don't need you to tell me how I should or should not talk to my friends. Apparently you do, fucking sexist prick. Before Vikas could reply, Garima was on her feet. Just leave it alone. You don't know me. You don't know him. What are you trying to prove? RF, suddenly aware of the situation brewing in his house, sprung into action. Fuck you, Rohit. Don't make a scene for no reason, he said. He walked straight up to the bigger guy and stood right in front of him. Rohit couldn't get to his feet even if he wanted to. Vineet was just on his way out. He's dropping you home. What do you mean, no reason? You heard what he said to Garima, Rohit asked. Calm down. Time to go home. Tell me about it tomorrow, Arif said. He looked at Vineet, the younger boy, cutting the lines. What the fuck are you talking about? This motherfucker needs to be taught a lesson. Rohit lunged at Vikas. He didn't get very far. Arif grabbed him. It wasn't pretty. They both fell to the floor, grappling. It took a few moments before they were separated. Get the fuck out of my house, Arif said. Fuck you, man. You should be backing me on this. She's here with you and seems to be too dumb to get when someone is being a prick, Rohit said, getting to his feet. You, my friend, cannot talk about her like that, Vikas said. Oh, now you have a conscience, motherfucker, Rohit retorted. Do you want me to get enough people together to throw you out? Arif asked. Vineet, ghar leke jana isko. Vineet put his arm around Rohit and the two left. It's not the first time it has happened, said a girl who'd been sitting next to Vikas earlier in the evening. Vikas realized he was holding Garima's bottle of wine in his hand. His grip on it had tightened. It's not like he would ever swing it, he thought. Never. Not a real party unless someone loses their shit, right? Arif said. Almost instantaneously, the tension in the room vanished. Sorry about that, guys. That's a friend. Not a smart one, but he's coming from a good place. You all right, man? He asked Vikas. No issues, Vikas said. He took a swig from the bottle of wine in his hand. Where's your loo? Arif pointed it out. I'm glad you're staying, Garima said to Vikas, just before he walked away. It was late. The room had emptied out. After a fun conversation that went on longer than Vikas realized, Anu and Disha said their goodbyes. The remaining guests sat in a loose circle. They looked like a tight-knit group of friends. Vikas was holding a bottle of wine. The need for glasses had passed. The conversation seemed animated, but he tried to find an excuse to stay away from it. The trick was to make it look natural. The music had died out. Nobody noticed him replace the phone connected to the music system with his own. or so he thought. "I saw that," said a voice from behind him. The tone was curt. He turned around instantly. "My brother is probably wasted if he put you in charge of the music. He must really like you," said the girl standing over him. "I just met him today, actually," Vikas said. "Oh, then you better take the bottle away from the system," she said. "Sorry," Vikas said. He picked up the bottle. "Can you check and make sure there are no stains on the table? I'll hold the bottle for you." Vikas did as he was told. He was relieved. Firstly, there were no stains on the table. More importantly, the girl behind him took a swig from the bottle. "What is this music? Doesn't sound like something my little brother's friends listen to," she said. "It's LCD sound system. This was their last album ever. They put out this masterpiece and decided to quit while they were on top," he said. "Why quit? One of them popped it?" "Actually, no. They did this epic show in New York and just called it quits as a band at the peak of their powers. But then they reunited recently and decided to come back. Doesn't sound as romantic now." "Actually, they might have had an album after this before they called it quits." "Shit, that's a fuck all story to tell." "Yes, it is. You should stop. I'm going to get some food. I don't think this party is going to happen for me. Have you eaten?" "I don't mind getting some food. Is it okay if I get some with you?" "Sure, come." The two of them helped themselves to some food. There was plenty in the kitchen. They decided to sit on the kitchen counter with their plates. The bottle of wine sat between them. "So, how come you're here? I don't think I've seen you before." "Do you know Garima? She asked me to come along with her. I'm Vikas, by the way." "I'm Amina." "Which one is Garima? Is she the one in the red dress? She's cute. Are you two together?" "No, but I think your brother and her might be soon." "Does that bother you? Actually, wait. What are you doing? Don't talk to me about my brother and his girls." "You asked." "How come you're not in the party mode?" "I went out for a quiet drink and came home to this rager. Just didn't feel up for it. There was some good wine in the house, so I took it in my room. Arif's friends tend to get a little juvenile when they're drunk. I mean, they're fun, but if you're not in the right mood, it's a bit much." "I know what you mean. I found out the hard way. Pray tell." Vikas could only hope his companion enjoyed their banter as much as him. He was glad she didn't walk away as soon as she finished her meal. She seemed amused by his stories and even shared some of her own. He felt at ease talking to this girl he had never met before, sitting in her kitchen. There was enough alcohol in his system to ward off any anxiety. "Okay, decision time. I'll pop another bottle open if you're sharing one. It's fair since I drank most of yours. You can go back to your friends if you want. I'll take a glass out for myself," Amina said. She led him out of the kitchen. "Of course I'd like some wine. If you're popping open some fancy stuff, don't bother. There might be some more of these in the fridge." "Doesn't matter. I'm going to open it anyway. With all of you here, we'll open at least two more bottles. I'd rather drink the nicest stuff. I'm sure someone will finish the other one." Her logic was sound. "Back in a sec," she said, walking down the corridor. He waited by the kitchen door. The music in the living room was still the album he had queued up. "Someone Great," a song about a relationship ending, seemed like the perfect score to this interaction with Amina. "I wish that we could talk about it, but there, that's the problem," James Murphy wallowed. "So have you decided?" she asked. She walked back into the kitchen and opened a fresh bottle of Chilean Shiraz. "On what?" "On whether you want to go back to the party or sit in my room and finish this quietly." It was never a decision. "You should be really glad you have some good taste in music. We wouldn't be hanging out if you didn't," she said. He had no smart retorts. He shifted his weight, sitting a little more comfortably on the side of her bed. "Here, play some more," she said. She gave him her laptop. "It should already be synced." She walked up and down her room, picking up things and moving them around. Her bag, some clothes on the floor, her phone. He noticed her lock the door. He didn't say a word, but his heart skipped a beat. "Yes, it's locked. Don't get too excited," she said. He knew what he wanted to play, but took his time pretending to browse through options. "Do you mind if I just queue up an album?" "You're in charge," she said. His eyes were on the screen in front of him, but his attention was completely focused on her. She had taken off the sweatshirt she was wearing. The bottom of a loose-fitting vest slipped away from the elastic band holding up her pajamas. She tied her hair into a bun on top of her head. He wasn't sure if she glanced towards him before she did it. In one quick motion, she unhooked the clasp on her bra, dropped its straps off her shoulder, and pulled it out from under her waist. His breath was short and shallow. The national's trouble will find me now, fit perfectly with the yellow light from her bedside lamp. The two of them passed the wine back and forth. She adjusted her top. Vikas wondered if she caught him staring down it. She didn't seem to care. They talked about intimate things, like how many people they were truly honest with. Neither of them had a large number. Time got away from them until Amina's phone rang. Surely, it was inappropriate to ask who was calling her at that hour, Vikas thought. Unfortunately, the response to his unasked question was the worst he could imagine. In that moment, his imagination was not at its best. Time for you to get to work. Karma wants you to take her home, she said. You're joking. Nope, that was Arif. Time to leave. Can't Arif take her? I'm sure he's tired. I didn't ask for any details. But I'm not going to tell my brother that he needs to take her home because her friend is busy with me. No problem at all. Allow me to tell them both. Don't be stupid. What do you think was going to happen here? You probably can't even get it up. Vikas sat up to see a massive grin on her face. Only one way to find out. What is life without some mysteries? She said. She slid off the bed and walked over to the mirror, adjusting her hair. Come on, Vikas obliged unwillingly. Before she opened the door, Amina gave him a quick pat on his chest and kiss on his cheek. Thanks for a wonderful evening, Vikas. It was an absolute pleasure, Amina. With her face so close to his, he noticed the small mole on her forehead. He hadn't noticed it before, but liked the way it looked. She opened the door and walked out. Where were you? Ready to leave? Garima asked. Yep, he said. Vikas said goodbye to Arif and gave Amina a hug goodnight. Both siblings waited by the door to see them off. They were the last ones to leave the party. Garima was already telling him about her evening. Vikas was glad she wasn't asking questions. He listened. A lot of what she said didn't register, but it wasn't for a lack of interest. They found an auto easily. Vikas put his arm around Garima and they rode homeward. Both highly inebriated. Both with their thoughts on one of Mr. and Mrs. Banatwala's children.